A very good morning to all of you. As I told you yesterday, we are going to take up the characteristic features of romantic poetry. Specifically, the purpose of this discussion is to give you a brief introduction to the characteristics of romantic poetry before we move on to discuss two great romantic poets, Shelley and Keats. The period of romantic poetry began in 1798 with the publication of Lyrical Ballads, a collection of poems composed by Wordsworth and Coleridge. The preface to Lyrical Ballads denounced the poetic diction of the preceding century and proposed to deal with materials from common life in a selection of language really used by common men. The poems in that volume not only marked a significant change in poetic diction, but showed a quite different attitude to poetry in general. The cause of this attitudinal change may be traced to the socio-political situation of the period. The 18th century regarded society as a great constructive force which ideally holds all ranks of people together in mutually supporting harmony. But society for the Romantics had become an evil force, a dark, repressive cloud, limiting action and obscuring perception, said Claire Lamont. Politically, the Romantic period coincided with the French Revolution. In its idealistic early stage, the Romantic movement, like the French Revolution, involved breaking out of the restrictive patterns of the past. The movement was also inspired by the revolution in America and the popular wars of independence in Poland, Spain, and Greece. Philosophically, the Romantic movement was a reaction against the rationalism and scientism of the 18th century. Emotionally, it was an extreme assertion of the self. When the validity of reason as the only method of inquiry came to be questioned, the value of the individual's varied experiences obtained due importance. It can also be called subjectivity. In addition to that was the sense of infinite and the transcendental. 1832, generally taken as the end of the Romantic period, was the year in which the Reform Bill was passed in England. It marked the end of a phase of political agitations in the country and the beginning of a strong democracy. Let us now look at the few characteristics of romantic poetry. The first is innovation. In literature, breaking away from the past inevitably results in new forms. The romantic poetry sought for and found new forms and style without regard for classical precedent. For example, the serious or tragic treatment of lowly subjects in common language violated the basic neoclassic rules of classroom of decorum. Romantic poetry rendered the charm of novelty to things of every day. Next to it, the poet's isolation from society. Rejecting society as an evil force which stunts its citizens, the romantic poet became a solitary figure engaged in a quest. The quest is often long and sometimes very elusive. The rebel as the protagonist in many important romantic works is an indication of the romantic poet's isolation and personal quest. The poet's isolated sensibility, as Stephen Spender said in his preface to A Choice of English Romantic Poetry, often takes an egotistic form which sets up tremendous claims. For example, Wordsworth demanded an intuitive understanding and oneness with nature, which was his quest. Shelley's claim that poets were the unacknowledged legislators of mankind is inextricable from his quest. And Keats sought to achieve complete self-realization in a world created by the imagination. Furthermore, the whole 18th century demanded for objectivity and rationality was denounced by the romantic poets. Objectivity and rationality have little place in the world of the self. Next characteristic feature of romantic poetry is flight from the city. It was not merely the society and its traditional attitudes that the romantics denounced. The whole classical interest in cities was rejected. The classical literature had undoubtedly been metropolitan. It was associated with Greek cities and with Rome. The English classicism was centered around London. The romantics rejected the culture of urbanization and industrialization, and Shelley declared that hell is a city much like London. The same can also be observed. The same rejection of urbanization and industrialization can also be observed in Wordsworth's poetry also. I would like to mention here especially "The World is Too Much with Us," which is prescribed for you, and also "Under Westminster Bridge." Then, the next characteristic feature of romantic poetry is that romantic poets sought refuge in nature. Fleeing from the increasing interest in urbanization and industrialization, the romantics took refuge in the simple, primitive nature. Wordsworth's poetry once again is an example here. While their predecessors, the Augustans, looked on nature as something incomplete and hence the need of men's help for its fulfillment, the romantics regarded nature as independent of man. It was man, according to these poets, who, I'm quoting here C. Lamont again, the man who needed the help of nature to fulfill himself. I'm reminded here of Wordsworth's Lucy poems and Wordsworth's famous poem, 3 years she grew in sun and shower, where the poet has very explicitly shown how nature has shaped the personality of the little girl, being an impulse as well as a law in her life. Consequently, nature became a persistent subject of romantic poetry. It is generally described with accuracy and sensuous nuance. Yes, sensuousness is a special quality of Keats's poetry. However, nature is not presented for its own sake. It becomes a stimulus for the poet to engage in meditation about some important human problems, to arouse his or her sense of sensuous beauty, and so on. Next to that, the romantic poetry is characterized by withdrawal to inner experience. The romantics took refuge in nature because its vastness and mysteriousness provided them with infinite ways of exercising their imagination. The romantic tendency is a tendency away from actuality. Speaking of this tendency, Leslis Abercrombie says, quote, "We see the spirit of the mind withdrawing more and more on the things it finds within itself," unquote. The romantics withdraw from outer experiences in order to concentrate on inner experiences. It is a withdrawal from things perceived to things conceived. Northrop Frye identifies two poles of mental activity. Northrop Frye has written a famous book, Seven Types of Ambiguity. One is what he calls sense, that is the recognition of what is presented by experience. The other pole is the purely formalizing or constructive aspect of the mind. In this attitude, reality is something brought into being by the act of one's construction. While the pre-Romantic poets, Collins, Gray, Cooper, etc., While in pre-romantic poetry, there is a strong affinity with the attitude called sense. In romantic poetry, the emphasis is on the constructive part of the mind. Fry goes on to the extent of saying that the poetic technique of the romantics is akin to magic, which also aims at bringing spiritual forces into reality through concentration on a certain type of experience. It is also akin to romance, with its efforts to maintain a self-consistent idealized world without the intrusion of realism or irony. Next is importance or significance of imagination in romantic poetry. The 18th century rationalism had relegated imagination to a secondary place. The poets of that century approved of fancy, provided it was controlled by judgment. For them, the poet is an interpreter rather than creator, concerned with showing the attraction of what we already know. According to the romantics, on the contrary, imagination is the greatest faculty of a poet. Mind is the central point and governing factor, and the most vital activity of the mind is imagination, according to romantics. Imagination sees things to which the ordinary intelligence is blind. Coleridge claims that imagination partakes of the creative ability of God. For Wordsworth, Keats, and Shelley, imagination is concerned with a supernatural order. To cite one example here, again from a very, very well-known common poem by Wordsworth, The Solitary Reaper. It is Wordsworth's imagination that had forced him to compare the song of the reaper girl's beauty with that of the cuckoo bird or the nightingale, and nightingale also singing to the caravan of travelers in the Arabian sense. His imagination conjures up the two most beautiful songs around him in nature, and then he propounds the fact that the song of the reaper girl surpassed the beauty of the songs of the cuckoo bird singing to those who were listening to the song of the cuckoo across the Hebrides Islands, or the nightingale's song which was sung to the tired travelers in the shady haunts of Arabian desert. Now, next is creation of reality. The romantic poets withdraw themselves into their inner experience, and with the help of their imagination give shape to a new kind of reality. In the words of Stephen Spender again, I quote here, "At the back of the romantic movement is the idea that poetry creates its own kind of reality," unquote. Keats gives the impression that the world of the imagination is realer than the real world. Realer than the real world. In Shelley, we find a world of imagination transforming the real world by a kind of chemical action, moving outwards from the imagination until finally it affects the shape of the society. Wordsworth creates his kind of reality by fusion of two shaping minds, one of nature and the other of the poet. What this poetic creation of reality implies is a condition of affairs where poetry becomes the judge over life and society rather than vice versa. Stephen further argues that the distinction between what is real and what is imagined is rather blurred in the world of romantic poetry. It does not mean that the imagined world is the real world. What the poet believes in is the power of the creative imagination to invoke an ideal world, and in this ideal world, everything imagined is a means by which the poet lives his life into his poetry. Next is romanticism is not opposed to classicism. Although romanticism rebelled against the neoclassicism of the century that preceded it, it is not the antithesis of classicism. Classicism is a holistic combination of the different elements of art. Romanticism is one element of art and hence of classicism. We can detect elements of romanticism in classical works also. The difference is that whilst classicism holds the various elements of art in a balanced proportion, romanticism has one element dominating its poetry. Abercrombie, who upholds his views, says that the true antithesis of romanticism is not classicism, but realism, which is another element of art. I conclude at this point and we'll meet next time with another poem by romantics or romantic poets. Thank you so much.